Welcome back to another episode of Engineering Today, and I hope you're all having a great time. Elon Musk has shared the plans for the upcoming Starship mission after a successful static fire test of the giant rocket. The next launch, expected in early May, will focus on safely bringing the Starship back to Earth from orbit for the first time. SpaceX recently completed a second static fire test of the Ship 29 rocket in Texas, and it fired up all six of its engines. Elon Musk mentioned on X that they are preparing for Flight 4 of Starship. The main goal of this mission is for the Starship to go through maximum re-entry heat while keeping all systems working. When a spacecraft re-enters, it faces intense heat due to friction with the air. Starship needs to prove that it can handle this heat, which is crucial for its future missions. As we all know, Starship isn't just about space exploration. It's also designed for practical purposes like carrying people on long interplanetary trips, delivering satellites into orbit, establishing bases on the moon, and even providing point-to-point transport on Earth. Gwynne Shotwell, SpaceX's chief operating officer, mentioned that the next launch attempt could happen in early May without any payload on board. The focus will be on fixing issues from the previous mission. They've already repaired the OLM for the Launch 4. Moreover, SpaceX plans to do more test flights this year, around six more. They want to make sure Starship works perfectly and can be used multiple times like a big space taxi. But they have to follow the rules from the Federal Aviation Administration before they can do more launches. The FAA is still investigating what happened during the last flight, so SpaceX has to wait for the green light before they can launch again. Meanwhile, SpaceX recently made headlines by launching two rockets from Florida within a short span of about 4 hours. This feat adds to their impressive track record, as they set a launch frequency record in 2023 and are aiming for even greater achievements in 2024. The first launch occurred at 5:52 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time on Saturday, March 30th from NASA's Kennedy Space Center. A Falcon 9 rocket carried the Eutelsat-36D telecommunications satellite into orbit. Shortly after, at 9:30 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, another Falcon 9 lifted 23 Starlink satellites from Cape Canaveral. What's remarkable is that SpaceX had a third launch as well, showcasing their determination to push the boundaries of space exploration. The third mission, which was launched from Vandenberg Space Force Base in California. SpaceX's dominance in the satellite launch market is evident from their impressive launch schedule. In 2023 alone, they successfully completed 96 Falcon 9 missions, surpassing their previous records. This year, they aim to launch 144 orbital missions, a testament to their ambitious goals and capabilities. One of SpaceX's key strengths lies in the reusability of its Falcon 9 rockets. Both rockets launched on Saturday returned to Earth for an iconic booster landing, marking the 16th landing for one booster and the 12th for another. This reusability record is a significant achievement, and it allowed SpaceX to reduce costs and improve efficiency in space missions. On the other hand, NASA's big plan for Starship is gradually becoming reality. NASA's Artemis program is not just about landing the astronauts on the moon. It's also about making big changes on the moon itself. They're building a space station called the Gateway that will orbit the moon. This station will help astronauts live and work on the moon more easily. The Gateway has two main parts being built right now. One is called the power and propulsion element, which is like the station's engine and power source. It uses solar power to move around and provide electricity. The other part is the Habitation and Logistics Outpost, or HALO, which is where astronauts will live and work while they're at the Gateway. These parts are being made by two companies, Maxar Technologies and Northrop Grumman. SpaceX will launch these parts into space so they can be put together to form the Gateway. NASA chose SpaceX for this job in 2021, and it's expected to happen in late 2024 or early 2025. Once everything is up there, astronauts from the Artemis 4 mission will go to the Gateway. Artemis 3 will be the first mission where astronauts actually land on the moon, but it's been delayed to 2026 because of some tests. But why do we need the Gateway? It's because it will make it easier for scientists to study the moon and help us set up a base there that can support astronauts for a long time. Astronauts can do research on things like space weather, how space affects our bodies, and other important topics. The Gateway is like a stepping stone to bigger things in space exploration. It's like the International Space Station, but around the moon instead of Earth. This station will have spots where other spaceships can come and hang out, kind of like a space parking lot. The Gateway will be put into orbit around the moon in a way that it goes over both the north and south pole areas of the moon. NASA thinks this is better for doing science stuff and for getting to the moon's surface. It's very evident that Artemis 4 is going to be super exciting. It'll bring something called IHAB to Gateway. The whole reason for doing all this is to get ready for going to Mars. NASA wants to use the Gateway to practice and learn before sending people to Mars. In other news, the Russian space industry has faced significant challenges over the last decade, impacting its global competitiveness. The Proton rocket, a long-standing workhorse, encountered reliability issues and is nearing retirement. The newer Angara rocket, although promising, is still in the testing phase and lacks reusability. Additionally, geopolitical tensions have limited Russia's access to lucrative Western markets. One of the core issues facing Russia's space industry is its reliance on outdated technology compared to the innovative approaches seen in the global launch market. While Russia once attracted commercial satellite launches, it now struggles to compete with SpaceX, India, and China, who have embraced advancements in launch technology. In contrast to Russia's limited launches using variants of the Soyuz vehicle, SpaceX has launched a significant number of rockets, demonstrating a higher level of activity and innovation. China, too, has surpassed Russia in terms of launch frequency. To regain its competitive edge, Russia has outlined a strategy to revitalize its space industry. Yuri Borisov, the chief of Roscosmos, the Russian space corporation, detailed this strategy in a recent interview. The first step involves developing a partially reusable replacement for the Soyuz rocket, known as Amur-CNG. Additionally, Russia is working on ultralight boosters with reusability features. The Amur rocket, fueled by liquefied methane, is designed to be partially reusable, similar to SpaceX's Falcon 9. Initial plans for Amur aimed at offering launches at a lower price point compared to competitors, with a target payload capacity to low Earth orbit. However, the timeline for Amur's debut has faced delays. Originally projected for a 2026 launch, Borisov now suggests that it may not be ready until 2028 or 2029. This delay highlights the challenges Russia faces in realizing its ambitions for a renewed space industry presence. Regaining Russia's former position in the space industry, especially with SpaceX's dominance, presents significant challenges. SpaceX has demonstrated remarkable innovation and success, leading many to believe that they'll play a crucial role in humanity's journey toward becoming a multi-planetary species. While Russia's plans for the Amur-CNG rocket show ambition, the delays and uncertainties in implementation raise doubts about their ability to compete with SpaceX. SpaceX's relentless pace of innovation and successful execution of missions set a high bar for other players in the industry. On a slightly different note, astronomers have found something really strange in space that could help us understand how our galaxy, the Milky Way, came to be. It's a group of stars called Ursa Major 3 Unions 1, located about 30,000 light-years away. This group has only 60 stars that we can see, which is about 16 times the mass of our Sun. And it's all packed into an area just 10 light-years across. The name of this group shows that astronomers aren't sure what it is exactly. Sometimes, small galaxies that orbit bigger ones, like our Milky Way, are named after the constellation they're in, which is Ursa Major in this case. But sometimes, faint star clusters, like this one, are named after the projects that discover them. In this case, it's called UMA3/U1, because of the projects that spotted it, like the Union's project using the Canada-France-Hawaii telescope and the Pan-STARRS project. Now, why is this group of stars so interesting? Well, there are two big ideas about what it might be. One is that it's a tiny galaxy, held together by a lot of dark matter. Dark matter is this mysterious stuff that we can't see directly, but we know it's there because of its effects on things we can see, like stars. The other idea is that it's a star cluster that we caught at a very special time just before it falls apart. If it's a tiny galaxy, it could help us answer some big questions about how the Milky Way was formed. Scientists think that galaxies form when smaller things, like dwarf galaxies, which have a lot of dark matter, come together to make bigger galaxies, like ours. According to this idea, there should be lots of dwarf galaxies around our Milky Way, but we've only found about 50 of them. That's weird because we expected to find hundreds of them based on our theories. Some of the galaxies we've found are called ultra-faint dwarfs, which have a few thousand stars and a lot of dark matter. But UMA3/U1 is even fainter, with way fewer stars and much less mass. So if it's a dwarf galaxy, it could mean that there are more of these super faint galaxies out there that we just haven't noticed yet. Scientists used a special instrument called the Deep Imaging Multi-Object Spectrograph to study the stars in UMA3/U1. They found that the stars are moving in a way that suggests they're being held together by a lot of dark matter. This would make UMA3/U1 one of the galaxies with the highest ratio of dark matter to visible matter that we know about. But why are there so few stars in UMA3/U1? It's possible that in the past, there was a burst of star formation where lots of stars formed quickly. These stars would have produced a lot of energy and explosions when they died, which could have blown away the gas needed to make more stars. That's why there are only 60 stars left today, and they're the faintest and longest-lived stars from that ancient burst of star formation. This discovery challenges what we thought we knew about galaxies and how they form. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting, and kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.